Hi everybody, it's a pleasure for me to be here with you to discuss this exciting new field. As we know, after the entry into the hepatocytes, HBV genome is converted into a very highly stable DNA molecule, the so-called circular covalently closed DNA. cccc DNA acts as a mini chromosome, allowing HBV to establish a persistent infection. cccc DNA is the driver of HBV replication. It's used as a template for the synthesis of viral messenger RNAs. One of these messenger RNA is defined as a pre-genomic RNA and is then converted into DNA by HBV reverse transcriptase. cccc DNA transcriptional activity is strictly modulated by the extent of immune responses against the virus, and the delicate balance between cccc DNA transcriptional activity and the immune response plays a pivotal role in liver disease progression. The quantification of cccc DNA in clinical practice is hampered by the need to carry out liver biopsies, highlighting the need of serum biomarkers that can reflect the extent of intrahepatic HBV reservoir. Among the classical HBV reservoir, serum HBV DNA is usually considered the best indicator of viral replication. However, the production of HBV DNA is suppressed by the currently available NUC treatment. So, this biomarker cannot provide information on the extent of HBV reservoir in successfully treated patients. Another important biomarker is quantitative HBsAg. As we know, quantitative HBsAg has been used to set up the stopping rules to interferon alpha and plays an important role in the setting of HBeAg negative and low viremic patients, since it allows to differentiate between HBeAg negative infection and HBeAg negative hepatitis. Furthermore, quantitative HBsAg has been shown to predict the risk of vertical transmission and indeed can help identifying pregnant women candidate to antiviral treatment. Quantitative cccc DNA correlates with intrahepatic amount of cccc DNA in HBeAg positive patients. Conversely, this correlation is completely lost in the setting of HBeAg negative hepatitis. And this result can be related to the issue of HBV DNA integration into human genome. Indeed, different elegant studies have shown that in HBeAg negative patients, integrated HBV DNA can be a source of HBsAg. This means that our patient might have reached HBV functional cure, but we cannot realize it since HBsAg continues to be produced by integrated HBV DNA. So, overall findings again highlight the need of novel, innovative biomarkers to accurately reflect the extent of intrahepatic HBV reservoir in terms of cccc DNA burden and in terms of cccc DNA transcriptional activity. On one hand, the scientific community is moving towards a sort of optimization of the classical biomarkers. Optimization means going beyond the simple qualitative detection of the biomarker and allowing the quantification of the biomarker itself. And this is the case of HBeAg and anti-CoR. In particular, different studies have shown that quantitative HBeAg, in particular the decline of HBeAg during treatment, can help predicting HBeAg0 conversion during either interferon or nuke treatment. What about the other optimized biomarker, anticor? Anticor titer has been proposed to reflect the strength of immunological response against the virus. Indeed, these antibodies play a role in antibody-dependent cytotoxicity. According to its biological function, anticor titer correlates with ALT, correlates with the extent of liver damage, and in particular, different studies have found that a high anticor titer can predict either spontaneous or drug-induced HBeAg0 conversion. Furthermore, and interestingly, anticor titer may play a role in the diagnosis of occult HBV infection that, as you know, is defined as the presence of cccDNA in the liver in an individual who is negative to HBsAg. In particular, this study was led on liver biopsies from anticor positive and HBsAg negative patients, and the study shows that a specific threshold of anticor titer can predict the intrahepatic presence of cccDNA. Presumably, the presence of a transcriptionally active cccDNA that can produce viral antigens and thus can stimulate the production of these antibodies. At this regard, I would like briefly discuss with you the issue of occult HBV infection. The diagnosis of occult HBV infection is challenging, and as reported by the recent Taormina statements, it should also involve the use of highly sensitive assays for the quantification of nucleic acids, including digital droplet PCR. And at this regard, I would like to share with you this clinical case. This is the clinical case of an infant who underwent liver transplantation as a consequence of Alagille syndrome. She contracted an occult HBV infection from an anticor positive liver donor despite successful vaccination. At the beginning, the status of immune suppression determines a sort of seronegative occult HBV infection characterized by the negativity to anticor, to HBs, to serum HBV DNA. Anticor appeared later, presumably as a consequence of immune reconstitution. We had the possibility to quantify cccDNA and pregenomic RNA in liver biopsies, as well as serum HBV DNA by highly sensitive digital droplet PCR. And we found the existence of a transcriptionally active cccDNA, a transcriptionally active intrahepatic reservoir, while serum HBV DNA was one copy per ml, indicating an ongoing viral replication, albeit limited, but a viral replication that in the long run might contribute to liver inflammation and might represent a cofactor for the onset of liver cancer. By NGS, we also found an enrichment of vaccine escape mutations in HBsAg that might have contributed to the transmission of the infection despite vaccination. Beyond optimization, the scientific community is also investigating the role of two novel, innovative biomarkers, correlated antigen and serum HBV RNA. Which is the virological meaning of these biomarkers? correlated antigen reflects the production of three different proteins that are produced by the same viral gene. These proteins are the capsid protein, the HBeAg, of course, in the setting of HBeAg positive patients, and the P22, that is a peculiar protein, an aberrant protein present in naked virions. This elegant study by the group of Fabien Zulim shows that correlated antigen correlates with the intrahepatic amount of cccDNA, but most importantly, and particularly in HBeAg negative patients, correlate with pregenomic RNA, suggesting that this biomarker can reflect cccDNA transcriptional activity. Another intriguing and fascinating biomarker is serum HBV RNA. We all know that the infected hepatocytes can release DNA-containing virions. However, HBV is a virus that never stops amazing us, and thus beyond DNA-containing virions, the infected hepatocytes can also release RNA-containing virions. But which is the nature of this RNA? This RNA mainly represents pregenomic RNA that failed to be converted into DNA by reverse transcriptase. And indeed, different studies have shown that serum HBV RNA correlate with the intrahepatic amount of pregenomic RNA and is more genetically homogeneous to pregenomic RNA than to cccDNA, again supporting that this biomarker can reflect cccDNA transcriptional activity. According to their virological meaning, which can be the positioning in clinical practice of these biomarkers? Different studies have shown that these biomarkers, the levels of these biomarkers, vary during the natural history of a chronic HBV infection, reaching the lowest level in the setting of HBeAg negative infection. For this reason, these biomarkers have been proposed to predict the differential diagnosis between HBeAg negative infection and HBeAg negative hepatitis. Furthermore, we know that interferon alpha can reduce cccDNA transcriptional activity. For this reason, these biomarkers have been proposed to predict sustained virological response to this drug. And in particular, different studies agree on the fact that a low level of these biomarkers at baseline or their steeper decline during treatment correlate with a higher rate of response to this drug. However, it's now necessary to understand if these biomarkers can actually improve the current stopping rule to interferon treatment. Interestingly, the production of these biomarkers, is not affected, is not hampered by NUC treatment. And thus, both correlated antigen and the serum HBV RNA can be used to have information on the extent of intrahepatic reservoir. And this is particularly relevant for serum HBV RNA. Indeed, by suppressing the production of HBV DNA, RNA-containing virions become the most prominent type of virions during NUC treatment. At this regard, this study presented at last EASL shows that long-term NUC treatment, very long NUC treatment, can determine a progressive decline in correlated antigen and the serum HBV RNA. After 5 years of treatment, most patients have undetectable correlated antigen and the serum HBV RNA, suggesting a progressive weakening of cccDNA transcriptional activity. And in line with this concept, this study shows that an undetectable serum HBV RNA at NUC suspension correlates with the lack of virological rebound after NUC withdrawal. And we can now discuss the issue of NUC suspension in HBeAg negative patients under prolonged virological treatment, virological suppression. This was a pioneering study showing that the suspension of NUC treatment determines, as expected, an increase in serum HBV DNA, followed by the achievement of HBeAg negative infection state and of HBsAg loss in a quite substantially high proportion of patients. However, in the setting of NUC suspension, we have the diagnostic objective to identify those patients that can safely suspend NUC treatment and that can benefit from NUC suspension without experiencing important rebound in serum HBV DNA and, in turn, important flares in transaminases. At this regard, different studies, including this one, show that a low HBsAg at NUC suspension correlates with a higher rate of HBsAg loss. And this prediction, this correlation, seems to be improved when HBsAg is combined with correlated antigen. Furthermore, this study, again presented at the last EASL, shows that an undetectable correlated antigen and pre-genomic RNA is strictly associated with the lack of clinical relapse. So overall findings support that a limited intrahepatic reservoir, a limited cccDNA transcriptional activity is a prerequisite for a safe and successful NUC suspension. Furthermore, as reported in this study by the group of Bertoletti, another prerequisite for a safe NUC suspension is the existence of an optimal immunological control on the virus that can avoid important rebound in viremia and, in turn, important flares in transaminases. And indeed, in line with this concept, this study shows that a high anticorp titer at NUC suspension correlates with a lower risk of clinical relapse. And so we can imagine that in the next future, we can integrate these biomarkers to identify patients with a limited intrahepatic reservoir and an optimal immunological control that can safely and successfully suspend NUC treatment, or to identify patients with a large intrahepatic reservoir and a suboptimal immunological control that should continue NUC treatment, perhaps introducing a new anti-HBV drug. Finally, another issue in which these biomarkers can provide an added value is represented by immune suppression-driven HBV reactivation. If diagnosed late, HBV reactivation can lead to severe forms of hepatitis. In particular, in this setting, we have the diagnostic objective to define those anticorp positive and HBsAg negative patients that are at higher HBV reactivation risk, and thus those patients who need antiviral prophylaxis. Several studies have shown that a low anti-HBS or an undetectable anti-HBS before starting immune suppressive therapy correlate with a higher HBV reactivation rate. And this correlation is increased, is enhanced when anti-HBS is associated, is combined with anti-CoR. In particular, this study has identified two specific thresholds for anti-HBS and anti-CoR associated with a higher risk of HBV reactivation. In the setting of HBV reactivation, ultrasensitive assays might provide an added value, and this can be the case of ultrasensitive HBsAg. At this regard, I would like to present you this clinical case. This is the clinical case of an onco-hematological patient with an occult HBV infection at screening. During 2 years of lamivudine prophylaxis, the patient was persistently negative to serum HBV DNA, and we are talking about undetectable serum HBV DNA, persistently negative to the classical HBsAg with normal transaminases. Conversely, the patient was repeatedly positive to the high sensitive HBsAg. As soon as viral prophylaxis was withdrawn, the patient experienced a rebound in viremia followed by a flare in transaminases. Of course, further studies are necessary. However, this clinical case can suggest that highly sensitive assays might be useful to identify patients who will need prolonged antiviral prophylaxis and/or a more potent anti-HBV drug. And finally, we can discuss the issue of Delta virus, the smallest RNA virus causing the most severe forms of hepatitis. In this setting, we cannot talk about novel biomarkers since we should first improve the classical biomarkers for viral replication. In particular, regarding the quantification of serum HDV RNA, this study highlights the urgent need to standardize the assays for the quantification of serum HDV RNA, since there's a high heterogeneity among the different assays. Regarding Delta antigen, I would like to present you this clinical case. This is the clinical case of a 42-year-old man, positive to HBsAg since the age of 5 years. On March 2019, serum HBV DNA was less than 10 international units per ml. HBsAg was around 10,000 international units. The patient resulted positive to antibodies against the Delta virus, while Delta antigen was negative. The patient was sent to our hospital for the quantification of a serum HDV RNA that resulted to be 3 million copies per ml. So in this clinical case, Delta antigen failed to detect high-level viral replication. We know that Delta virus is characterized by a high degree of genetic variability, and this high genetic variability might have hampered the recognition of Delta antigen by diagnostic antibodies. So, in conclusion, so far we are at the beginning of a new era. However, there's a lot of work to do in terms of standardization of the biomarkers, in terms of understanding factors affecting their quantification. Furthermore, it's necessary to understand the proper positioning of the novel biomarkers in clinical practice and how to integrate them with the classical biomarkers. And this is crucial if we want to set up a precision medicine approach to our patient. And I thank you for your attention.